you for joining in. It's Henry van Rooyen from H3 Lofts. Just a quick update on what's going on. It's today the 18th of April. Yeah, how can I forget? A day before my wife's 40th birthday. So yes, thank you for joining. Like I said, it's going to be a quick one. So we finally decided what we're going to be doing in terms of the training. We haven't been tossing the birds yet. Many, if not all, of my fellow fanciers in the club is on the road already, which makes me feel quite lonely and nervous because I'm behind. But so the decision has been made that the birds are finally ready for the road. So we will be tossing as of this Saturday. If the dogs can just stop barking and I can actually hear myself speak, it'll be nice. So we're going to... this Saturday, we were going to start off with a 10-kilometer toss. Sunday, we have a family commitment with my father's birthday. So they will just have open loft. And as of Monday, this is where the crisis is actually at. Because of time constraints, I have no choice but to take them to work every morning, which is, as the crow fly, 26 kilometers from my house, which is not a problem. They should be able to fly that even if it's the first toss. The problem that I've got is it's in the opposite direction of in which we fly. So that is a bit of a problem. So it remains to be seen what that's going to mean. But we don't have a choice. So we're going to toss them the 26 kilometers every day, Monday to Friday. And then next weekend, weekend after this one, we will then toss a little bit further. We will go around 30 kilometers on the Saturday. Another 30 on the Wednesday, on the Sunday, and then we'll toss during the week. We're going to go to work in the opposite direction again, and every weekend we're going to go further and further, up until we are basketing the main race on the 23rd of May, and we're liberating on the 25th. We do have a mock race that is scheduled for basketing on the 10th and liberation on the 11th. Well, the weekend, I think it's the 11th liberation, but my birds won't be ready. It's going to be about 200 kilometers as the crow flies. And I've just had a look at my schedule and I don't think my birds will be at that distance yet. So I'm going to skip that one, unfortunately. But we will then be ready for the first sprint race, which is then... the 23rd of May will be basketing. So, but the furthest we will go with the birds will actually be 100 kilometers. I won't take them further than that. We might go as far as 150 at the most. I found in previous years going further than 100 is not really necessary. I would like to liberate the birds with the truck at some point, or mass liberation, to give them that experience of breaking out. But I will not be tossing with the union truck for two reasons. Number one, my birds won't be ready at the distance when they start at the 30th of April. They're already starting at, I think, 80 kilometers. I will not be there yet. And the other thing is also, I found in previous years, when you toss on the union truck, or that was my experience, is you're very likely to get sick birds in the beginning. Young bird sickness and all of those things. And then people say yes, but when they basket, you need to raise them with other birds anyway. I say that's true, but however, I found that in the beginning, before the race season, people do tend to basket all their birds for training, and they're in a rush, and they're much less careful to what they basket, and there are a lot more sick pigeons on the truck on the training tosses than what they are on the races. And in the racing season, the clubs have officials, well, we do in our club anyway, officials that make sure that the birds that is entered is actually healthy. We won't allow pigeons that's vomiting or having diarrhea or loose droppings or blatantly sick pigeons will not be allowed to be basketed. So yes, there's less in the racing season, there's less sick birds. So I won't be taking part in the truck tosses, but I might just go and liberate at the same point so they have the experience of breaking out of the group. So yeah, that is pretty much in terms of our training. I will put up the program and I will just go, I will just go through the program with you guys a little bit, and the race points and my thoughts on these things. The initial plan was actually to fly in two different unions, both the WRRPA and the PSWU, but for reasons, you know, financial reasons and other reasons and time constraints, I don't think it will be feasible for us to fly in both unions. So we're sitting now, our club is members of both unions. So it's a situation where we need to decide in which union are we going to race. The WRRPA is not favorable in terms of loft position where we are at. We are much more favorably situated with the PSWU. But the other thing is, in the WRRPA, I believe there's the competition is a bit more stiff because we're also part of the Pretoria West, Gauteng West Combine, which makes the competition a bit stiffer, and you can test your birds against more people. But in PSWU, there's also a lot of good competition there, and we are more favorably situated. So I'm a bit in between two places to decide which of the two unions we're going to fly. But nevertheless, there will be 36 races that we will be flying, and then there will be 24 odd sprint races. So all in all, it's about 50 races that we, somewhere there, that we're going to be partaking in, and we're going to take you on the journey. So thank you for that. Before we go, we're just going to show you something that we'll be doing, how we're going to be assessing our birds before we actually send them to the races. And we're going to do a little experiment of which we will now involve you guys and show you what we're going to do. And we're going to test the effectiveness and the theories that comes with it. And this grading system is actually something I learned from one of my mentors. So we'll just go through that. So we're going to take notes of all our birds. We're going to grade them and give them points. And the end of the season, we're going to actually look at the performing birds. What was the initial grading? And the non-performing, what was their grading, and see if it holds any water and truth. And then as the season progresses, we will go through it. And after the season, we will also let you guys know what happened and if it's an effective way of grading or scoring birds. So yeah, thank you. We'll just pause here. Okay, thank you guys. So just a quick one on, now that we're going to be tossing and then the racing season is actually approaching, I'm just going to go through our grading system for the birds. Now we're doing this pre-season because the only real test is the basket and the race basket and the racing itself. But I actually want to test this grading system. At the end of the season, we're going to see which pigeons performed and what was their points allotted to them before the actual first race. So there are five criteria that we use to grade our birds. And we'll go through them one by one, and we're going to grade this one bird as an example. And my son and myself, we will then, before we actually start racing, we will make sure that we've graded all the birds and written them down, and we will share the results as the season progresses. So nevertheless, the five criteria is, the first one is feet, throat, wing, build, and then feather quality. So that is the five criteria we've got. We allot 2 points to each criteria. So it's when it's excellent, it gets 2 points. When it's just medium or there, it's 1 point. When it's bad, it gets a zero. So the best is a point out of 10. So 2 times 5 is 10. And then that's how we will grade the bird. So let's go through the criteria quickly. The first one up, and this is not in any order of importance, but if I can choose the most important out of the five, it will be the throat. If I can only choose one of the five to grade birds, I'll do the throat. But we are going to use the five, and we are going to allot equal points to each. So let's look at the feet. So I don't know if you can see, it is dark now. But this one has got very good feet. Can you see the cushions of the feet? They flat. They are not swollen. They don't have any warts or this stuff, skin, you know, that it swells and it looks like it's very like a chicken's feet.
It's soft, it's flat. That means it's got good blood circulation. So actually this bird on the feet, it scores a 2. Now the second thing that we're going to look at is the throat. Now I can't, it's dark, so I won't do the throat. You won't be able to see it on the camera, but I've done this one's throat already. So when you open your pigeon's throat, make sure the tongue lies nice and flat in the back and it doesn't move too much. So the first thing I'm looking for is the bottom throat. The breathing hole needs to be shaped like a rugby ball or keyhole. Not round, not open. It shouldn't be opening up and closing and making all sorts of funny things. It should be slit-like, like a keyhole shape, and lying flat. Then I also like the bottom throat should be flat against the tonsil, and it should be not falling to the left, to the right, or to the back, but sitting flat against the tonsil. And then also, very important on this, if a bird has a perfect throat but you find yellow dots at the back of the throat, that disqualifies the throat for me immediately, because that's either a sign of canker cells that has formed, or it can be a paratyphoid. So it means that the immunity of the bird is compromised, and at some point during its season it's going to get sick. It doesn't have a good immunity. So I don't like that. We disqualify on that. This one luckily does not have that, so it scores points. The other thing that we look at is then the top of the throat on the tonsil. I want that line straight and very narrow, like a human hair thickness. That's what we want. So that means that the carburetor is working, the pigeon can breathe. This one has got all the structures I just mentioned, apart from at the top it's got a bit wider at the tonsil, and it's not completely straight. It's a little bit skewed, not much, but it is. Therefore I can't give it a 2, and I'm gonna give the throat a 1. Then we are gonna look at the wing. The most important thing for me on the wing, when I open the wing, many people open the wings like that, but I don't like doing that, because a pigeon don't fly like that. A pigeon fly like this. That's how it flies. When it rows its wing, this is how it flies. But everyone's got their own way. People like to open up the wing. But for this case, I will open the wing like this. If you look at the back covering there, I like the feathers to cover the back. I don't want the wing to fall off the back like this. But like this one, it's well covered and it's dense. So that is good. This is a shortish wing. But if you can see the flight feathers, the last three, is nearly the same length. I like that as well. And the step between the 6th to the 7th, there's a nice little step there. So I like that. So this bird's wing is actually giving me a 2. And of course, before I forget, the last thing that I check on the wing is the short forearm. So you must only be able to get one finger, or barely a finger, under the forearm, like so. Must be able to get, when you put your finger, shouldn't have a long forearm. The shorter the forearm, the faster it will row its wings. Okay. And I also like a wing, when I open the wing, it should have a bit of resistance. It should be strong. It tells me that the bird is strong and it's got vitality. So this wing I like, according to my preferences. Everyone has their own, so I will give it a 2. Now we're going to go to the build. When I talk about the build of a pigeon, I don't like a pigeon that is too heavy. Yes, your feeding and the weight of the pigeon has got a lot to do with it, but pigeons that are heavy and lady are usually born that way. They're quite heavy in the hand. This one is buoyant. When I hold this pigeon, it feels like, if I close my eyes and imagine, if it will float. If I put this pigeon on water, it will float. It's balanced. It sits in my hand perfectly, like a dart. It's well balanced, so it's built nicely. Its breast muscles are well developed. It sits more to the front. It doesn't have a very deep keel, but it doesn't have a shallow keel either. So that's also part of the build. I like that. So it is very well muscled. When I rub my fingers against the breastbone onto the muscle, I can actually feel the muscles rippling underneath the skin. So it's also a sign of vitality. And if you look at the feather, at the tail, it's got one feather there. And if I hold it back, it doesn't go up or down, but it keeps its back strong, but it's still flexible. So that is a good sign. And then the vent bones on this one, I like a narrow vent, but also a strong vent. And this one has got both. So this particular bird on build, according to our preferences, will get a 2. Then lastly is the feathers. When I talk about feathers, I'll talk about feather quality. Feather quality, they need to be soft as silk. So when you hold it in your hand, it's almost slipping out of your hand. You should feel, and if you want to feel the feather quality, take your palm of your hand. Well, this is what I do anyway. And I like to rub my hand against the wing like that, and then to feel the quality of the feather. And you get the sense that this pigeon's got a lot of feather and it's dense. So when I open up the wing, there's also a lot of louvering. So the air can come through here, but there's no gaps in the wing, like so. There's very few thread marks. The one thing that does count against this pigeon is the white flights. It's not the bird's fault. Many pigeons, great pigeons, has white flights. I just found that white flight seems to wither away easier than the darker flights. And this is the very same pigeon that we fixed the flight with the steam the other night. You can see the 10th flight is perfectly formed now, and that worked well. The feathers are beautifully soft, and I do like it. I do like it, apart from the white flight. So I'm going to give this one also a 2 on the feathers. So this particular bird, and this is my favorite, that's why I chose it. It's going to be the highest scoring in my loft at the moment. So if I count my points, it's 2, 3, it's 5, 6, 7, it's 9 out of 10, which is very rare. I don't know if I've got any more 9s out of 10s, but we are going to score all of them. There are some that is only scoring at a 7 or 8. When it comes to 6s and 5s, then I choose rather not fly those birds and remove them from the team. However, we'll give everyone a fair chance, and we're going to test this system first this year. We're going to score all the birds, and if I say this one is a 9 out of 10 and it flies rubbish and it gets lost after the first race, and we're going to look at all of them, then we'll see at the end of the season how accurate were we with the assessment of the birds, and then only you can make your decisions on whether you think this system will work. But let us try it for you first, and we'll see if it works. Then you know you've got something to work on in terms of grading and also selecting your birds. Thank you, everyone. Tune in again tomorrow for another one. The time is near, and we're going to be tossing birds, so it's exciting and good times ahead. Thank you, everyone.